Greetings, everyone.
Thank you.
Welcome into this space.
Greetings.
I'm still admitting people who are arriving in the next few minutes at high speed. I first want to kind of be that I want to celebrate with you. I want this to start with a celebration because, in a way, this work talk, we've had other work talks about Game World, we've had other work talks about Archiarchy, and at the same time, this is sort of the first official work talk about the Game World Builder School, and that we are really clarifying that now that we have disability management, that we have people have really built skill, and a lot of you have been around possibility management and the possibilitator training for years or months, is that many of us have built skill in terms of the ability to hold space for evolutionary processes and initiations and different kind of non-material value of family, community, love, connection, clarity, possibility. And I think we really needed a solid circle or so solid community of people who could deliver enthusiastically and unreasonably their non-material value to the people around them, that we could start having this conversation of, let's build a game world, like, let's make sense, like, let's organize, let's have a conversation about how does this non-material value can be scaled or can be deepened or researched and documented and shared. And that's this conversation about game world. So even if the distinction of game world has been around for 5, 6, 7 years, maybe, I think we're just at the beginning of discovering the potential of it. And I'm glad that you're here researching this potential with us together. So I just want to say, we probably will not be doing any practical exercises in an hour and a half. And so this is more going to be a research space and a sharing space. So really, at any time you want to ask a question or say, I don't understand this, or how does that really work practically, or what the hell are you talking about? Just please interrupt us, because it's your question and your necessity that's going to make this space really valuable for you and for the other people in the room.
I'd just like to say how each one of you or each one of us represents non-material value that is not understood in modern culture. It's not recognized, it's not named, it's not even probably appreciated, but it's important in terms of next culture and being a human being. And so I don't know about you, but I looked around a lot in modern culture for my place. Where is my place here? You know, even when I went to college, they said, what do you want to study? And nobody ever really asked me that before. So I told them the truth. I said, I want to study magic. I want to study transformation. I want to study alchemy and healing. I want to study paraphysics and metaphysics. And they said, wait, we have physics. That's what they offered me, was physics. So I studied physics. But what I'm saying is that there is not a place for what you are. I mean, this is what I found. There was no place for me in modern culture, which left me with, you know, these two options or three options: commit suicide, you know, or submit myself to the existing structures, the formats that already exist. You know, I could be a fireman, I could be an army colonel in the army, I could be an inventor at Microsoft, you know, programming new code, you know, okay. None of those things fit my actual path. And so I think I'm telling your story, actually. I feel like I'm telling each one of this is your story. And so you get to this place where if you're not going to commit suicide and you're not going to adapt to fit in, and essentially commit spiritual suicide, you know, really give up on yourself and try to conform and fit into modern culture structures. If you don't do the first two, you're only left with one choice, which is to reinvent the world for yourself so that you can have a place to fit in. And that's where the idea of the clarity about game worlds came from, is that actually all the structures in modern culture and ancient culture are all game worlds, all of them, including culture itself, is a game world. And game worlds have common characteristics. And some of the characteristics are, one of them is you need to know how to participate in the game world or you cannot participate in it. Okay, well, this, we're born into modern culture that all the game worlds are all already designed. And so our parents teach us how to behave in the post office, how to have a birthday party, you know, how to go and buy stuff in a grocery store, et cetera, et cetera. How to vote, whatever the game world is, our parents introduced us to this as if it were true, as if it were reality. And the shocking, powerful, and revolutionary realization that comes with game worlds is to discover that it's entirely fictitious. Every single game world is fabricated out of nothing. And once you understand that, it gives you the freedom of movement to invent your own game worlds. And when people offer you a game world to play and you go, I'm just not interested in your game world. I have other game worlds that I'm participating in, and yours looks boring and destructive of planet Earth, or just not very interesting. And so what we're saying is that you've got so much power, and we're hoping to do only clarify it and support that power that you have, so that you can not only build the game world for your own non-material value to thrive and provide services and for other people, not only that, but also to teach other people about game worlds and empower them in your workshops and trainings and spaces of healing and empowerment and all that.
I mean, that would be what Clinton just said. In a way, it's that you would not be able to talk about how does your game world go without including the distinction game world, because people function in they function, like Clinton said, they function as from a set of assumption, from a set of what they were told of. For example, there's an authority figure, you have to give your center away to the authority figure. Very classic rule of engagement of a modern culture game world. There's a boss, you give your center away to the boss decide, you know, there's a teacher. And if you build a game world and you say, there's no authority figure here, we're working in a circle and I don't want your center, I want you to have your own authority, it will sound crazy to most people. It will sound revolutionary. It will sound, you know, it's like, okay, how do I even do that? Like, what are you talking about? And then it would, that's, in that regard, it's a useful distinction, like ability to say, look, we're functioning here in a different culture. This is not modern culture. We're functioning in a different culture. And this is how this culture goes. And let me tell you how this culture goes. So in terms of this conversation is probably a few steps ahead of the title of the workshop, the work talk, that's start your game, your arc in game world. But we're painting the picture of like where we're going with this.
So we'd like to begin by hearing from a few of you what game worlds you would like to start, are already starting, have started, and where you are with that. So if anybody would like to share a little bit about that, and any particular question that goes along with where you are in your game world building. Marcus, it looked like you were going to say something.
Yeah.
Go.
Yeah, so my most recent project that I'm excited about is how to build a food corporation to deliver food in a way so that we use less and less plastic. And I've become just so excited about the fact that I'm intelligent enough and my people, or we are intelligent enough and powerful enough to start inventing this on our own and to really like explore how to make these food chains, or where to get food from, or how to make it local and to meet people. And what is so exciting about this for me is that it has this huge opportunity for me to build relation with people. And that's where I'm at right now. And it is actually, like, I remember 1 year ago we were speaking about your quest, and I think you, Clinton, spoke about it, that there's this possibility when you wake up and you just, like, you put your feet into the shoes of your quest.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm finding with this. And it, to me, what struck me before was that I was building so much or envisioning so much energy into the non-material value game worlds that I was building before. So, for example, in Freiburg Rage Club and Fear Club and all these other circles. And there was this day when I noticed I also want to be putting my time and energy into something, into some structure that is actually also material. And especially the food, because it's something that I'm eating every day and people are eating every day. And so that's, I think, where I'm having the most questions right now is this emergence of bringing together a game world where we're using or dealing with material goods and having people that are playing in that game world. And it does make a difference when these people, as you said, Anne-Chloé, have their own authority and can just play so much better together. And so that's, I'm in the middle of the process of discovery and team building.
Thank you, Marcus. Is the food cooperative in Freiburg, Germany?
Yeah, it's going to, we'll have our first place in Ebringen. And so it's 20 kilometers from Freiburg. And then,
thank you.
I actually hope to change a whole Freiburg food system with this. Yeah.
Yay. Nano Nation of Freiburg is emerging.
Are you okay if I slide something?
Yeah.
So I just want to say that it is shocking. I mean, Clinton and I have multiple conversations with different people who say, okay, I'm ready to build my game world. I've been through enough healing and transformation and initiation, and now I'm ready to step into my quest and to build my game world. How do I create a game world with a business? You know, and immediately there's this orientation towards, if I'm going to build a game world, I need a legal entity that's going to hold it, such as a business or an association or nonprofit. And I want to say very clearly that in archaearchy, none of those things exist. Businesses, nonprofit, and association, they don't exist at all. And so you do not need a legal support to build the game world that you want to live in and you want to see flourish.
So that's the first piece of your thought where that you can just throw in the trash can. That, you know, you have to go down to fill out a form, declare the name of your business and get a tax number. You can just tear that piece up and just throw it away, because that whole, how do you say, rule of law, mm-hmm, that is designed to promote corporate personhood and the concept of profit and the concept of ownership, et cetera, concept of stocks and bonds, all those things. That entire game world is what's eliminating life on planet Earth at the fastest possible rate. So you just skip that. You just leave it behind as a stupid game world. People tried it. It did not work. Walk in a different place. Start over. And you don't, because if as soon as you start going and filling out the forms and you know, shrinking your game world in to fit into the structures, the pre-existing structures of modern culture, you have contaminated, mm-hmm, your game world. It is contaminated from this very start. And so I'm encouraging you to skip that part and realize you're planting a point of origin in a culture that is not included in modern culture at all. Zero. It's not included at all. Start over. Go ahead.
So basically what you need to start a game world, preferably to have more than you, involved in the possibility of that game world. So it's when two people are gathered in the possibility, like when two people are gathered in the name of that possibility. So you need, you know, two people and a name. And that's it. Two people and a name, you have a game world.
We encourage three people.
And we do encourage three people. Because if you have two people, usually what would happen is your boxes are very similar. And then you have a friend, you kind of have a friend box relationship in a game world, which limits the possibility of what can happen because you have similar boxes. Or you have kind of enemy boxes, and the result is kind of an ongoing box war. So if you have three people, then the third person is always this force of possibility, this force of transformation.
Yeah, there's these three forces to be aware of. One is the assertive force, one is the denying force, and one is the sustaining force. And the third person plays the role of the sustaining force, like to carry through the evolution. The liquid state of the evolution is the sustaining force to carry it through that.
And just as a side note, if there's a couple will often be one person. You know, they're like one box, they're kind of together. So you would need two other people in addition to the couple. Great. And then one thing that we do recommend pretty soon, really pretty soon, is when you have the core team, what we would call the core team, three people, plus the name, is to immediately start building your website. So that when you start talking about, hey, I'm building a food cooperative, and it has a, does it have a name, Marcus, already? We've lost Marcus. Great. Let us know when you come back. So then you say, you know, I'm building this food cooperative. You know, the first thing that I would do if people tell me what they build is I'm going to go online and see what are they, you know, what are they talking about? You know, what? And so in terms of visibility and credibility, just build a website and consider that it will ongoingly be a draft. And it's the rules of engagement. It's how does your game world go? Who's involved in the game world? What's the purpose of the game world? What is the service that you offer? What is the service that you offer? And that's it. That's that goes into a website. And it's really a powerful alchemical act to start writing, because it puts your vision, like your heart, what the value that you contain inside of yourself, it puts it into an element that is like on earth, like in the field. You're putting your value into the field instead of having it only inside of you.
Mm-hmm. So anybody anywhere in the entire world, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, can enter your game world, can discover your game world. And so that's the purpose of the website. And just to be clear, we are fond of a platform called strikingly.com, strikingly.com, as a platform for free websites building. And it's efficient, fast, effective, it's fun, it's clear, it's easy to use, and free. So there's no excuse. You don't have to use WordPress, for example. You don't have to pay for some special name or something. Yeah, thank you.
Great. Is there somebody else you have an idea of a game world, or you're building one, or one that's already built you want to share? Or any? Yeah.
Hello. Yes. Hi. We have a game world built. It's called Heart in Nature. I have been recording sounds of the biospheres for maybe 7 years, and I create albums. And I've been connecting with indigenous communities in Central America, where I'm from, to connect with them and have some of the funds of the downloads of the sound albums to fund regeneration, land regeneration, through the indigenous communities. And Beth is on the team as well. And we need two more people as well. Yeah.
Tamar, can you say,
we have a website.
Okay, great. What's the edge of the game world? Like, what's the question or the...
It is to instill the culture of listening, deep listening, and being with Gaia through our listening.
My question was a little different. It's like, what's the next step of evolution for the game world?
For your game world
of Heart in Nature.
Yes, to build a bigger team and keep growing, to be able to disseminate more of this information. I've been doing it by myself. Beth came along about 2 years ago, but we really need to grow more.
Thank you. Yeah, I think not just right now, but we'll talk a little bit about, we found out these six steps of game world collapse, and it has to do with team building. And we want to share them with you so that you're already aware of the hurdles that could come along the way. But
I also want to share a website we have called Your Circle, yourcircle.mystrikingly.com, which every game world needs to grow in a way, because if it's not growing, it's collapsing. It's basically that your choice. You can't have really a stable game world. It just doesn't exist in nature. So it's either growing or dying. And so the way that your game world will grow is about building your circle. We call it your circle of people. And you have kind of concentric rings of people who are attracted to your game world. So the ones that are way on the outside have just heard about it. Next ring in, they subscribe to your newsletter. And the next ring in, they actually participate in a workshop or a work talk or your process that you're offering. And the next ring in is they want to contribute. They want to be in a full-time, in a big training, or they want to help you win. And then you have this inner, it's not the inner ring, that's confusing. It's actually called the infinity ring of the people who taking radical responsibility for your game world to fly. And that's called your infinity ring. And actually in the diagrams that I've been using, I put that on the outside so that people can connect with the people sourcing your game world easiest. So it's like not on the inside, because then there's like an inner circle of people. And that's not at all what it's about. It's a circle that's radically responsible. And there's always more room in that circle when people show up who are able to be responsible in those things that make the game world grow.
And to be really clear that this infinity ring, so this circle of people who are sourcing the game world and who are inventing new parts or deepening the context, they're not paid. They're not paid by you, and they're also not paid by the game world itself.
They're not employees.
So the way that they are part of this team, because that game world just turns them on. They want this game world to exist and to grow and to evolve and to exist really in the world. And the way they're generating their resources is by delivering their own non-material value to the world. That simple. And that mostly, I think, I don't know how many of you have had that experience, but the number of quote unquote hours that you, in archaearchy, that you would work for some kind of financial resource is so little compared to the time that you're spending, delivering your non-material value and building game worlds and being in teams and researching and documenting. And so
you say that a different way. I don't think people got it.
Okay. Which is, in archaearchy, this idea of a time equals money thoughtware completely disappears. And what really happens, what we discovered, is if you're, basically delivering your non-material value unreasonably, enthusiastically to the world in forms of, albums, in forms of documentation, articles, podcasts, interviews, trainings, work talks, just talking to people on the street, going to festival and having, cultural conversation with people in festivals, like all these ways that you're delivering your non-material value from your presence, you're indebting the universe towards yourself. The universe owes you a debt because you are delivering your non-material value and supporting the evolution of consciousness.
You're delivering absurd levels of value. Yeah.
And so it the balance gets unbalanced, the balance gets imbalanced, and that's when the universe starts flowing resources towards you. And only one of those is, let's say, money or currency. Mostly what the universe will flow is a team. What they will flow is coincidences. What they will flow is people willing to hold space for you for emotional healing processes, you know, taking you through initiations or offering you possibility or clarity. Or so all these resources, these are the main resources you actually need for your game world. You actually don't need money for your game world.
One thing to remember is that each of you, the way you're providing value, what your game world is about, is ahead of your time. You're ahead, you're beyond the leading edge of most human awareness on planet Earth. So it's not like you will go, here's a new brand of soda pop. It will keep you awake and full of some kind of drugs that will make you stay up longer. And we have a beautiful little can, you know, and everybody goes, I want some. I'm going to try it. Now, you know, what you're going to offer is some kind of awareness expansion process experience that is going to take your customers into breakdown. They're going to go in liquid states as their thought work upgrades, as their awareness expands, as they become more aware of what their actions are causing in the world that are not positive effects, as they start taking responsibility for trying something different, et cetera, et cetera. So there's a growing number of people who are tired of the Coca-Cola, you know, advertising. They are tired of the mainstream. And when possibility management first started back in 1998, there was essentially a flat desert where we were working. And so since 1998, we've been building the name Possibility Management, building the name Expand the Box, building the name, you know, laying out tools and processes and context and spaces where people can make spaces to teach people who can make more spaces. And so what's happening, and all the 300 million people who are cultural creatives around the world are working together, mostly disconnected from each other, but working together. And you can count on those other people. The 300 million around the world are doing this. And you don't know them, they don't know you, but we're changing the morphogenetic field of the Earth so that the interest is more like here now. It's more up on this kind of a curve. And so what means, we can watch this from year to year in possibility management, that, for example, that 5 years ago, 10 years ago, there were hardly so many people participating in this stuff. And now there's, whatever, we have 50 people coming to Expand the Box trainings, 40, 50 people coming to labs. And it's like, okay, we have to offer. Okay, so this is all water under the bridge. This is all stuff that you've done, we've done, the other people have done to make it possible to stand on each other's shoulders, hold each other's hands in the big circle, and just roll into next culture together. This is what we're doing with the game worlds. So the idea of there not being enough customers, like scarcity of customers, is such a common thing in modern culture. And it absolutely does not exist in the evolutionary work, in the awareness expansion work. There's no lack of customers on planet Earth. So if you ever have that feeling of, gosh, you know, okay, we have all the people in Freiburg who ever want to come to our, you know, buy organic carrots at the cooperative, or all the people who want to understand what nature noises are and what's really happening out there, you know, you're not close. You know, I mean, it's so wide open. It's hard to imagine how many people need and want, and they're sick, you know, they're unbalanced and ill because they don't have what you're offering. You know, you guys have such valuable stuff to offer. The only thing that's stopping you is you don't have your circle built. You haven't built out your circle and let people know what you're offering and what they can get from what you're offering. And so that's why this whole circle thing is so important. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, we're here in Brazil, and like every other day, there's some sound I hear in the jungle that's right outside my door that it scares the shit out of me because I don't know what it is. There's this one thing that goes, and God, if it's a chill down my back, and if it's some kind of monkey or lizard or something from the dark. I don't know what it is, but anyway, there's so much people need to understand about life on planet Earth. So I just wanted you to get it that you're ahead of your time, and it doesn't matter. Just really, that's the circumstances that you're in.
And I'd also like to throw in a currency that I think is giving, or at least for me, the biggest power of to build that game world. And it is that is, I do it basically first for my own enthusiasm. So I do it because it's fun for me. And that's why this, as you said, Uncle, it measures up, like the time I invest versus money, it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
And then also I experienced that this, my own enthusiasm, that's what is attractive to other people. Because I think it is, I'm assuming that it is for so many people on Earth a longing to experience your own enthusiasm. And if there's someone doing it, then these are the best people to become inspired by. And if you are it, then you're the best person to inspire others.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Somebody?
Wanted to hear from somebody who does not yet have a game world, but has some kind of vision. Like you want to build a game world, and it's coming from a place of necessity, enthusiasm, pain.
Maybe I have something to Marcus, and maybe it's something to your question too, because for me, or I have had the experience that the gap to be in the nothing, it's important for me. So if I don't be with this emptiness inside of me, I would like, or I create the old on the new way. And with this being with this fear of not knowing how something goes, it creates a game world inside of me just to try out. And after this time, there was something in me like, yes, and I need this free space to create something, and I would like to be fast and fast and fast and fast, and the old can go and the new have to be there. And it is a nice experience to be with this emptiness or not knowing how something goes.
So Christina, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Are you able to teach that to other mm-hmm. people?
Yes.
So you've done workshops and work talks, and you've written articles, maybe, or video, and you're sharing that with other people.
This about this emptiness and not knowing.
Yes.
Hmm.
And what's the name of it? So that's what Anne-Chloé is asking about. You are at the edge mm-hmm. where you have this value, where you're enthusiastic, like Marcus says, you have enthusiasm about nothing. and the power of the void, the emptiness, the potential of the void is immense, it's endless. And so if you can bring people through their emotional healing processes and their thought work upgrades so that they can change their relationship to that force of creation called the void or nothingness, the emptiness, groundlessness. If you give it a name and you start training people how to fly in the void. You know, we've got a website called Flying School. You might want to read it, flyingschool.mystrikingly.com, because nobody is delivering flying school. And it's so powerful and useful and necessary for people to fly, because if you can't walk over the edge of your box, if you can't put at least 1 foot over the edge into the nothing, you'll just be painting modern culture green, just like you said. You'll be doing the same thing modern culture is doing, painted green. But if you want to find something new, you've got to go into the unknown. And to go in the unknown is terrifying. It is groundless. And if that doesn't become home for you, then creation will not be your favorite thing to do in the morning. You will step up into doing things you already did before instead of inventing new stuff each day. And then the world will suffer and you will not be very enthusiastic. But if you step out of bed in the morning into nothing, that's going to wake you up right quick.
Yes, and after the last lab last weekend, it's the lab was about to be in relationship. And there's something like, I don't know how to be in a relationship. And with to be with this, it's on a new part. So on a new part of life. Last time it was another theme, and yes.
Thank you.
Somebody else?
Yeah, I would like to share. Hello, Katrin. Nice to see you. I'm not surprised you're here. sorry, we know each other from a place. So one thing that I'm dreaming is in my mind, it's called eco-conscious leadership, and it's bringing two passions of mine together, which is like mindfulness and becoming more conscious, raising your awareness pretty much of our interbeing with each other and with the world. And the eco is from ecology, like teaching people to understand the ecology, because many people act and they break this system that is supporting us for a long time already. So the point is kind of to raise awareness about how we can learn to live with the ecology and how we can build structures to relate with each other in a more constructive and more beautiful, fun, happy way.
How far are you?
How far am I? Well, I have it pretty much mapped out what it's needed, and now I'm looking for people that would like to join.
Do you have a website?
Not yet.
Okay, that's going to be your first step. And I would encourage you to not use vocabulary from mainstream modern culture, such as leadership. Unless you're trying to change modern culture. If you're trying to change modern culture, I suggest you will fail. Because if modern culture is good at one thing, it's good at spraying pepper spray in your eyes and shooting you with rubber bullets if you want to change something. Because modern culture is defended against change. It's functioning perfectly. It's not broken. It has no intention at all of ever changing. So if you're going to use vocabulary from modern culture, thinking that you're going to teach modern culture business people leadership, you know, they already have leaders. The leaders, I'm choking up about this. The leaders are the billionaires. You know, they're the billionaires. You think they want to change something? Guess again. So if you use the word leadership, you're automatically creating followership. And so I encourage you not to use the vocabulary that creates followership. And you can get your team together and come up with a different name. I mean, what came to me was eco-conscious invention. It's all about inventing next culture, inventing regenerative culture. And so that would be another possibility.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Clinton.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you. I'm working on an article, and the title goes something like, if you don't have a circle, it could be that it's because you're not in integrity with yourself. Meaning that there's this idea somehow of maybe wanting to say, okay, I'm going to build a bridge towards the people who don't know yet about the possibility of healing or growing up or being more conscious or being more in touch with, you know, Gaia or the ecology. And so therefore I'm going to twist sort of my vision. I'm going to twist my clarity. I'm going to kind of suppress a little bit who I am or what I want so that I can talk to these other people who are lost, something like that. And that idea is basically you are radiating this thing of not being really clear, not really being yourself. You're being adaptive. So the people you will attract as a people who are attracted by people who are adaptive. And that's the people in your circle. And it will be so painful because the experience is people don't get me. Like, or people are not really doing the work. Or I can't really like be myself around the people in my circle. So if you have any kind of these, you know, impression is, it's because, well, hell, you're not actually being yourself. And so therefore you're not attracting the people who would actually love to be around your being. And they are out there. The radical people, the vulnerable, you know, people who want radical relating, radical responsibility, radical honesty, you know, radical creation, radical invention, they exist in larger numbers than you think. And the thing that's really blocking us is really this fear, you know, this fear of being ourselves. And because it's just been crushed over and over again as, you know, as children, and also probably, this might sound a little weird in a game world work talk, but probably most of you also had past life where you had been killed for, you know, being, you know, an edge worker, like being a healer, being a creator of a different culture, or questioning the authority, or questioning the culture. And so therefore we have these experiences in ourselves of, God, if I really show up, you know, if I really shine and be radiant, mm-hmm. I'll just get killed again. I'll get humiliated. And these are gateway for emotional healing processes. And it does not take very long to go through them. But when they come up, just do them. This fear about being yourself, this fear about shining, this fear
speaking
about
speaking out.
Yeah, speaking out or thinking that you're too arrogant. Just do the emotional healing process. And there's about 5, 6, 7, like that's been my experience being around people on this path of 5, 6, 7, at least past life process. So it's not just, don't do just one and consider it's done. It's more than one.
So there's two things about this. One is, if your being had the qualities of a person who was already, could make this game world, the game world would already exist, would be in existence for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years already. If your being was already having the shape and the capability to create the game world, it would already exist. And so the information that you're getting is that since it does not yet exist, or since it's stuck, or since it's not fully blossomed, that's where you're stuck. And that's why these emotional healing processes are crucial. Mm-hmm. If you want your game world to expand, you expand. That's the key. Mm-hmm. So just throw yourself into emotional healing process. We know people who just, you know, 2 or 3 times a week, they're jumping into emotional healing process and their lives are just going like this beautiful garden is happening. Fruit is being, you know, coming out, you know, flowers and amazing animals and creatures and like sunlight. I mean, all this stuff is coming out of their garden because their being is unfolding. It's emerging. But if you don't do those emotional healing processes, for whatever reason, your game world will stay kind of where it is, because this is what you can manifest right now. So if you reinvent yourself, you reinvent your game world. That's one key. And the other key that we've been finding is, and Chloé just mentioned it, is it's really important to discover your own arrogance. To find in yourself a kind of arrogance. And I want to explain what that means, because in modern culture, in the way we were born and raised, arrogance is thought of as something bad. It's kind of overly self-assured or hurtful, you know, to the point of hurting others. It's like, I don't care. Arrogance mm-hmm. kind of means I don't care.
Shutting people out.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm right. You guys are all wrong. Whatever. Arrogance is like that. But there's a certain necessity for you to have to bring back a kind of outrageous level of arrogance, in so that you give yourself permission to do insane things, things that seem crazy. I mean, every new idea at first seems crazy, right? That's why it's a new idea. At first, it seems crazy. If it wasn't seeming to be crazy, everybody would be doing it already. So every new idea first seems crazy. If you don't have permission to be crazy and to actually try this stuff that you want to create, it won't happen. So the way to give yourself permission to do crazy stuff is to bring up a kind of arrogance. So you can mm-hmm. speak about it in new vocabulary that people don't even understand what you're talking about. And you speak full on straight to them about, you know, archy-archy, and we just brought to life Archan shamanism. So there's what is Archan shamanism? Well, it's the kind of shamanism they do in archy-archy. What the hell is that? I'm in a group, a team, where we figured out that the name for permaculture that includes inner permaculture and outer permaculture together in like whole permaculture, the name for that is Archan permaculture. What is Archan permaculture? It's the kind of permaculture they do in archy-archy. And so this takes arrogance. It takes arrogance to just say this stuff and just stand there and answer people's questions from that unknown place where it comes from, you know, where the new stuff comes from.
Catherine, something is happening. Would you tell us?
It's a mix out of joy and sadness, because I realized that in 2 days, 4 years ago, I had my abortion, and I want to reach out to other women with this experience, and I want to to explore what does healing mean, healing of this wound.
Yeah. Mm.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's really so many women and men. No, not just the women, but also the men who need that space. Mm. You know, and it's incredible. It's so mind-blowing. For me, it is still so mind-blowing. It slaps me every week or something to realize that if I can give a name to something and give, you know, be clear about the purpose, people can move into that. Possibilities that were not available before become available. And it's like, okay, that's how powerful I am. I mean, that's how powerful we really are, to be able to use, you know, this, whatever, our pain, our experiences, our necessity being, I want this to exist. I want a space where I can talk and heal this part of me.
You know, so Katrin, maybe your next step is to do a work talk on exactly mm-hmm. what you're talking about and bring a big box of tissues mm-hmm. so that you can just keep talking while you're crying. And other people, you know, so they can use them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and do the work talk and give it a name, a title. Your team can help you find a title for it. And then do a workshop about it. It takes a whole day or 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
And people's lives will change and they will unfold and they will get their energy back and new realizations and life can come back. Okay. Thank you. I want to hear from Elliot or Stefan. When you guys want to say something?
Yeah, you can hear me?
Yes.
Yes. Well, for me, it's kind of, there's a lot of disillusion, which I find out that it is kind of good, because my naivety is like immense. this is opening up for me recently, and each day is like something more opens up, and I go crazy about this. And the other thing is, well, I'm a musician, and I do some music stuff, and I teach like kindergarten and this education stuff, family, community, all this stuff opens up when I go angry, like, you know, like, I think I'm going to be crazy. Like, I'm seeing so much stuff and watching people not seeing it. I go like, ugh. And now I'm not really super smart or something, but as you say, this, I don't know. It's just, yeah, there's lots of anger, and I'm talking to people. It kind of, I'm kind of, I don't know. I think, cause you know, my family taught me to be nice and stuff, and I find out that I'm starting talking out some of this things, some of these things which pop up for me. I go like super heavy, and I kind of, I don't know, people go away, you know. It's like I'm not connecting, and I'm thinking about, well, you know, doing some workshops, and there are lots of ideas you mentioned, doing it, connecting the linear circle, getting the people who attract the idea. So a big part is speaking it out. And regardless of my education thing, you know, growing up in the family and the environment and all this shit makes you the person, the nice guy who you are, or you pretend you are. But in the inside, it's go like, you know, I need weapons, lots of weapons.
You know, Stefan, there's a thing you could have, a weekly meeting called a possibility team. And there's a website called Spark Experiment Team, but yeah. It's a space where you have 3, 4, 5 other people who actually come to your house, and you, the purpose of your meeting is to practice speaking into speaking to them about this stuff, about the dangerous stuff, the clear stuff, in a way that works better. And so the first few times they put you in a standing rage hold and you just scream your head off for the first few weeks. And then the second time, go, I don't need you to hold me this time. I'm going to do it. And the next time you can do it and you can go, okay, I have more clarity now. And you just keep practicing, but you need to start to blow up the volcano first. Mm-hmm. You have to. And so blow up the volcano. Like, don't, you've got the foot on the accelerator and the foot on the brakes at the same time. It'll make your hair turn gray. I mean, it's horrible. So look, so this thing is called a possibility team, or you can practice. Everybody can practice doing speaking what they need, what needs to be said, whatever needs to be said.
And people come to my place, or I go.
Yes. Or... Yeah, you pick one place every week, 7:30 Thursday evening at your place. 3, 4, 5. You put a little paper around town and go, look, I'm having a practice group for speaking.
It's speaking.
And then people come and they support each other. You guys support each other speaking in a way that works. And you pick the biggest stuff for people to speak about. There have been possibility teams going on for decades. Mm-hmm. It's so valuable for people. So, you know, I started my first possibility team in 1975. So just start one. There's great information. Thank you for sharing what you were sharing about.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stefan.
Thank you.
I want to speak up.
Go.
Because I want to train to speak up about this subject, which is game world. I am in a journey with that way to find where is my quest, my game world. And I'm in this moment, like as I heard Anne-Chloé saying about integrity, I want to be like to stay in my integrity. And now I'm in Italy, and I saw also Jacopo here. I wrote last year, on Facebook page, like the Italian Facebook page, possibility management page. Hello, I want to connect with you. Who are you? And so we start to connect with, and then we start a possibility team in Italian, and we start to do some things in Italian. And I did the coach training with Christina, and I now I'm sharing other on a studio to deliver my work as a coach here. And I sense that I'm a little bit lost in this moment, like really to where I will put my energy. Like it's to build the circle in Italy, it's to build my circle, and yeah, I sense that I'm putting my energy in many places, and I want to explore more about this integrity, really this integrity of my being, what my being is wants to do.
Thank you.
Yeah. There's an experiment that you can do more than one time. And what it is to just lay down on the floor in the middle somewhere, not in a bed or a couch, just really on the floor. And you just lay there and you do not move or speak or do anything until it comes out of you for real, until it's what you really, what you are comes out. And you might lay there for an hour, 6 hours. You might lay there for a couple days. You know, you just lay there until all this stuff falls off. And it's all distractions, all concepts, all you should, you must, you have to, like all this pressure from other people, your programming from your parents, you know, the culture. And you just don't move until it comes from you. And I encourage you to do that and then stay there, you know, stay in that space. And then you'll start having a different diet. You'll put on different clothes. You'll meet different people. You will do different things. You will start over again. It's a start over experiment. Tell people that you're fine, though. Tell people that you're going to do this experiment, and it's called the start over experiment, and that you'll be fine. They don't have to, like, call the doctor or something.
And that, Marina, I wouldn't worry so much about it, because it's sort of like, you got to enter the candy shop. You met possibility management, and possibility management is kind of like a candy shop. It's like, God, I could do Rage Club. God, I could do possibility to you. I could do coaching. I could do women's work. I could do parenting. It's like, oh, this is so amazing. And you're just kind of like, you know, overdosing on the candy shop. And you know, it's like kids, you know, at some point the candy thing will be like, okay, enough. You know, I've got enough of tasting everything. But at the same time, if you don't do it in the beginning, it's like you're blocking kind of that wildness of wanting to try things out. So you can consider that you're also in this phase of like, you're just trying things out in the candy shop, and there's a door, you know, at the end, and you'll get to that door, you know, eventually.
And you cannot take all the candies with you. So you'll just you take the ones you love the most.
And the candy shop is not going anywhere.
Yeah, right.
The candy shop will always be there. You can go back.
And then I lay down for 10 days.
Afterwards, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I have a possibility too. Are you open for this?
Yes.
From the feelings practitioner, use your sadness. Ein Deutscher, was bedeutet anlehnen im Englischen?
To lean on.
Lean on your sadness.
To lean on.
Use your sadness to
lean on.
Lean on, yes. Lean on to yourself from your inside. So use your sadness for your muscles and for your heart, and be intimacy with yourself. And be with this. And lean inside of you. And from this, you can go out.
Thank you.
That's my possibility.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jacqueline, what are you about?
Hello. I'm feeling fear, because I'm definitely in the candy shop right now. And I don't have the answer to what I want to do with all of it. I'm very much exploring. I've been in a washing machine of each piece the past couple of weeks, which has been amazing. I was really noticing myself light up when you were all talking about just like the power of the EHP to shift like a block go. So that was speaking to me. And yeah, I feel like I'm really in the candy shop, and I don't have my vision, my grand vision yet.
Jacqueline, at this point, what I would encourage you to do is to really build these spaceholder skills, build spaceholder skills so that I don't know, are you already delivering emotional healing processes for other people? Are you holding space?
Yes.
Great. So that's one, you know, first step. Another step is to hold space for a group. So like a possibility team or spark study group. So that was mentioned by Clinton. Mm-hmm. And then one of the next step would be learning to hold space for Rage Club. Because Rage Club, there you are in high feeling, kind of high intensity, highly transformational cooking chamber. And if you can hold space for Rage Club, basically what I've noticed training Rage Club spaceholders is that after Rage Club, clarity about, okay, I can do this. I can hold space for high intensity evolutionary process. So which dimension will I really hold space for? Like, what's my thing? What's my value? What's my flavor? What's my quality?
And don't expect it to stay the same.
Mm-hmm.
Just roll with it. You know, start with where you are and it will emerge. Don't expect it. I found my calling, you know. I've read my Paulo Coelho book, and now I found my calling. You know, it's not like that. It rolls along, and it goes this way and that way and this way, and just go along with it.
And so something that really helps in this rolling along, which is really a tradition of archaearchy, is to immediately start replacing yourself. Like, as you're starting to deliver what you're delivering, you're already planning that this will be temporary, and you're already replacing yourself.
Even if it's brand new, first time you're doing it, you start replacing yourself.
You have apprentices already, you know, in your first space, so that while they grow into being able to hold space for this value that you created, you can, you know, you're preparing yourself for the next step. And when you're ready for the next step, this bridge that you created is taken care of. Because if it's not taken care of, you will have so much pain of leaving it die, you know, letting it die. And that's one of the blocks to rolling along.
So even when you are an apprentice, you have apprentices apprenticing to your apprenticeship. Okay, how to be an apprentice, it's such a valuable thing. Yeah. How to pay attention, how to support, how to ask questions that add, you know, value to a space, all this apprenticeship skills.
Thank you both.
Thank you. Aye, Aye Brooken. Tell us about your project.
Wow, it's really hard for me to talk because I go so much along with everything what was said and with some of the processes of others. Yeah, so I think I'm kind of excited to be here. I don't know any one of you. I read the book. I worked with the book. I had own processes that were really very similar to what you do. So somebody suggested to me, hey, you have to read that. You have to go into that. And here I am, yeah. And it's quite a while that I'm in this void. And in the void, in the, like this process, I don't know who said that before, this just lying down and then everything falls off for hours and days. So this growing out of the inner child ego structure, it's kind of, you know, it's kind of I had amazing people to guide me. And yeah, so I find myself at a place of inner peace, of no more resistance, no fighting. And you know what resonates to me a lot is the word suicide, because in my former life it was always like that. I can't stand that anymore. I have to make an end of it. Or I know a lot of people who did it, who are doing it, and it really breaks my heart. And I think around that, together with something I'm kind of creating about metamorphosis, about the different rooms of metamorphosis that can be really playful, musical, lyric, rhythm. Each room is different from the next, and it's just a growing from one to the next to the next. So maybe there is a vision somehow that it's possible to learn the new language a little bit through these rooms and through the experience, through the playful experience, alone, but also in groups. Yeah. We once did it as a dance, like two people, the status quo and the new, and then going to these rooms, and what happened was so amazing. So yeah, I don't know if it makes any sense what I'm saying.
Yeah, it's
you know, the sun is just coming out and I'm sitting here in this. Yeah, so.
So look at Aya, can you imagine that what you're describing is really important and useful?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, can you imagine sharing that with other people, empowering them to go to ride the surf on the chaos of metamorphosis?
Yes, and somehow I'm doing it already.
How can I come to your meeting? When's your next meeting?
You meet online.
Can you say it again? You cut out for a moment.
Sorry. Are you coming to Berlin or
next meeting? When are you offering? What's the title of it? Where's the website? And how do I register? It's not about you. A game world is not about you. Yes, it needs to be something that feeds you, but your game world is not about you. It's about spaces that you provide for other people. If you're not providing it to other people, it's not a game world. And it's so you have this, each of us has a doorway. You're telling us about your doorway. Now you have this access to this clarity and possibility, and it's unique. Okay, well, we need it. And if you're just going to eat it yourself, then nobody gets it. But if you start giving work talks, workshops, you do, you know, articles, you make meetings, you know, that's where you start to give it away.
I know. And that is the next step. I know. What I just told you is the thing I went through to be able to provide it, to be a step ahead in a way.
Okay, or but maybe I still think you're keeping it to yourself. I still think you're hiding it. You've got it.
Visibility is dangerous. So
hell yes, that's the kind of possibilities we need. The ones that actually work, the ones that cause change, open doors to new spaces. So don't hide it. Okay, start figuring out ways. Get your team together. It will sound crazy. Don't worry about that. But start giving it away.
For those of you who are maybe not in some, we come together as a global community in Telegram groups. And so if you're missing like two people to be on your team of like, okay, I want to finally be visible with this. You know, I want to have a work talk. I want to have a meeting. I want to have a website. You can ask in this creation village, this possibility creation village, who would be two people who would be on my team for really for me to take my next step in building my game wall. So I'll send out the link in an email.
Oh yeah, thank you.
I'd like to hear from one of the two Olivers, or both of them, and Elliot and Sophia. Come on, you guys.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes, speak up though, speak loud. Shout.
Can't be too loud because there are people sleeping.
Yeah, wake them up.
Wake them up.
You've got something to say.
There's something that I'm kind of obsessed with, and it's called natural farming. It's like a way of relating to the land and to the soil, which just harnesses the power of nature, and it's just a beautiful system for relating to the land and growing food and farming. And
what's the name of your website?
Sorry?
What's the name of your website?
I don't have one.
Okay, by tomorrow, we need a website from you. It takes 5 minutes to set up a website. You're doing just like Aye. You're keeping gold and you're keeping it a secret. Mm-hmm. You know, we need that. We have a thing, you know, Archan permaculture needs
natural farming
stuff. Everything you learn is the treasure.
It's also already a game world as well. There's a game world out there called Korean Natural Farming, which is happening as well, which you could look.
Okay, Elliot, I want to say something. There's this idea that if the game world already exists, you have no permission to evolve it or grow it or, you know, be a part of it. And I would say just, you know, flush that assumption. I mean, if you love that stuff, all of it is actually copyleft. All of it is common creative. All of it is for Gaia. It's from Gaia for Gaia. To consider it, you're sourcing it. You are sourcing natural farming. And you can make a website about the part that you're sourcing.
And where you put videos on it, where you speak about your experiences.
Show people how to do this. Will you do that?
Yes.
Okay, by when?
In I committed last night, and in 2 weeks I will have a website, and I'm also going to be getting classes. I have a teacher coming to New Zealand to teach, and yeah. But within 2 weeks.
What about giving classes?
What about you teaching?
Yeah. I have a story that I don't know enough.
It's an emotional healing process.
Yeah.
Just call up Vera. She's sitting right there on the screen.
I'm going to put it like
this. Just call her up and say, do this emotional healing process for me that I don't know enough.
Yeah. The secret is, you know, it's been said so many times, but we teach best what we most need to learn. And so all of us, you know, saying, this is my game world, this is, What we're saying is, this is what I'm not good at. You know, this is what I want to learn how to do. This is why I'm unskilled. I don't have competence. And so therefore I'm holding space for a game wall for it. That's what we're basically all saying.
And Elliot, we've got this website called Archan Permaculture, and it's missing the natural farming part. It's missing that section because you didn't write it yet. You know.
This is amazing. Have you watched the Guyan Road Team interview of Mike Vernum?
Keith Barnum.
Earth Magic. And he learned natural farming in a hammock on a community somewhere on the west, east coast of America. That's how you learn natural farming.
So you learned it somehow, but the point is sharing it. That's the point.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to be a co-editor on the Archan Permaculture website, just tell me and I'll open up a space and you can just write stuff. Put up videos, all right?
Yeah.
You have to send me your email address. Or tell me what it is. Just tell me right now. What is your email address?
It's growyourownfood.
At?
Tutornota.com.
Tutta nota.
You know what that is?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, one of the Olivers. We need some olives.
Yeah, I'm going super slow at the moment. Just, I'm in a way doing this lying on the floor exercise for, I don't know, about 2 weeks now. Not literally, but I'm just taking it very slow because my physical body's is kind of
Oliver,
making me go slow. Yes.
I know you're going slow and all that stuff. We have a few minutes left. So cut to the point. Just go right to it.
Yeah, I'm sitting with that vision of like creating a space for next culture in around Freiburg together with Eva and Marcus. That's what we're sitting at the moment, or like what we're working on. And I'm really glad that we skipped from the idea of we need to kind of build a codex for the cooperative that we're gonna build to be able to buy a house or whatever. And we kind of skipped that and went on to like the codex of what we want to create, like what is the game world we want to live in. And right now it's kind of really a pretty broad thing, like for all the different activities we're kind of holding and we want to see flourish in Freiburg. And within that, the thing that's really dear to me is like a place to live together and create together and kind of have other people come visit and experience that, like a bridge house. And
talking like a Hogwarts bridge house.
Yes.
The Freiburg Hogwarts bridge house.
Yes. It can also be a Black Forest Hogwarts bridge house. Yeah.
Let's call it Hubwards because we were already speaking about it being a hub.
Okay, Hubwards.
Yeah, Hubwards.
Where's the website? Oliver, how can people find you?
Well, there is at least a PM Collective Freiburg. That's how we're starting. And I'm getting your point.
Thank you. Oliver 2. Oliver 2, where are you?
Oliver 2, yeah. Hi. It's the first time for me to be in such a work talk. It's great. I'm excited, very excited. And yesterday I have a commitment in my possibility team to go for creating a place for comedy and for doing some kind of relaxation therapy and such things, and with sounds like gong and handpan and monochords and so stuff. And I'm going with it. There's a web page, but it's not filled yet. Name is capsam.de and .org. It's like a shelter in Latin. And yeah, now I go. And I have to leave my business, I'm just in my business, the whole day today, like every day. I have to go the step from my business, last 30 years, now to the next step, next level.
Do you need anything from us right now?
Pardon?
Do you need anything from the team right now?
No, I just, for the moment, I'm filled up with...
Okay.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. Good luck. It sounds super. Sophia. Duarte.
Hi. You're muted.
Can you do it?
No.
Unmute yours. Yes.
Your side. Can you listen now?
Yes.
Yeah. I feel very excited and grateful to be here. My game world is more about mental health.
We need some of that.
I work with teenagers, and it's about a new vision for mental health, more focus on like the purpose of life. So this is about this disconnection now that we have in teenagers, and also not only, but the mental health for me is pretty much related with this disconnection from the earth and also from your main purpose, your soul purpose.
What is the name of that?
It's Be Human.
With just a letter B?
Yeah.
.org?
It's not on site. But now I know that I have I felt both things that I resonated a lot with what Anne-Chloé was talking about, both the compromise, because I always feel like I have to be a little bit the old doctor and not the new shaman so there is this compromising always that's kind of keeping me and I'm stuck. And also the fear I think I have from past lives of being really punished for these ideas and for the new. And I think I also already experienced it in this life. So yes. It's also present.
Time for arrogance. I mean, you know this stuff is valuable that you're doing. You know how important it is. So really, it's really up to you to take a stand for that.
Really. Yeah. But it really, really helps to have a team, Sophia, because in those moments of, you know, when the fear, you know, grips and the doubt comes, for me, it's like when that stuff come up, I call somebody and I say, you know, am I crazy? You know, can you give me some reality? And often, and most, you know, most of the time, the people will say, look, you're doing the work, you know, you're freaking out. It's totally normal, but keep going. Just keep going. So yeah. It's really great to have a team that can just keep, you know, putting you back on track.
Yeah.
And there's a question about the, to find a tool about
past life
stuff. We have a new website that's being made called Past Life Vow, and it has some great information on it already. That'll give you some hints about it. And I'm asking Anne-Chloé, if you will, she's just going to, will you just share with people these ways that new game worlds can collapse, so people just have an idea? This is on a website also. What's the name of the website?
It's called Game World Consulting. And you'll see the website is not completely finished, but there's great information on it. And we discovered this game world collapse from consulting a game world that was a community. So it came out of a community research, but it really applies to all game world. And it has these six or seven, it's like really six steps of places where the game world goes off track, like it is taken over by unconsciousness, basically. So the first one is, it usually happens really soon in building game worlds, is the illusion of we. It's like, let's come together. We have this, we all have the same vision. It's gonna be fantastic. And it's this kind of the pink, the excitement. And that can seem like the best part of the game world because there's all this enthusiasm. The thing is, the illusion is there is no we in responsibility. So having 10, 20, or 30 people coming around a vision, thinking we will make the game world happen, it's the first collapse in the game world. Okay, some.
So there's only one, two, or three people. You know, the three people are going to do it, not everybody else, not the we.
Who will really source it. So you'll see in the game world, there's the remedy, the intervention. Like, what kind of intervention can you do at what part of the collapse is your game world? So some game worlds keep going. They take this illusion of we, and they go into the second step of collapse, and it's everything is rosy. So, okay, we come together, we think, Wait, hold on. Sorry, I'm following my notes because I don't know it by heart. Okay, second step is we invest in trust in naivete. So that's the moment where you start buying land, you start putting big investments of time, especially of time and money and material. And this thing of, well, if we put resources, it will work out. And so usually there's a high fear at that point, but it's suppressed. Because the fear is saying, look, we're all being naive here about what's really going on, about who's really holding space for the project.
Yeah, it's like doing what looks like the easy work, you know, the easy thing first, but mm-hmm. and that is like shooting yourself in the foot. You know, you have to do the hard work first.
So the third step is this, everything is rosy. And that's this, okay, now we're in a game world together. Now we are, we've committed to our land, we've committed to money. So we're all going to pretend that it's working. So we all give hugs to each other. We're being nice. It's really this whole pretend phase of the game world. The fourth step, usually what happens is pretty soon the gremlin starts coming out. There's resentment, there's expectations, there's emotional reactivity, there's hooks. And then you have your game world is basically a feeding frenzy for gremlin. It's a hell world. And the thing is, if you really do not consciously have the distinction gremlin in your game world, people will come for the purpose of feeding their gremlin. And they will take your gremlin down they'll take your game world down just so that they can feed their gremlin.
You can just not let that happen. You can just say this game world is not available for gremlin feeding ground.
Yeah. Then what happens usually is that what is declared is the game world has failed. Mm-hmm. We've put all this money in, we thought we trusted each other, everything was rosy, then the gremlins came out and
We all feel betrayed.
You know, I cannot do what I wanted to do in the game world, so therefore the game world has failed. That's the fifth steps in this game world collapse.
Anybody ever experienced that before? Anybody? Yeah.
Could not do what you really wanted to do. Yeah. So I want to tell you that the further you go along of this collapse, the harder it is to start over. The more painful it is, the more crystallized people are in their resentment. So really, it's great to know the phases so that you can see them in your own game world and maybe also see them in other people's game world and be able to help them. And the sixth phase is people having a cognitive dissonance justification about why the game world failed. Meaning, instead of saying, I use this game world to feed my gremlin, they're like, well, it didn't work out because I changed my mind, or it didn't work out because I need to move to another part of the country, or it failed. You know, it's this justification about why I could not keep going into the game world. And it's a kind of dissonance about reality and this, how do I paint it over so that it is okay, basically? How do I make it okay for myself? Instead of being in the pain of, you know, like Christina said, it like just doing the old thing, just painted green.
Mm.
It's just the same thing, just painted green. Nothing really changed. So there's great information on the Game World Consulting website about that. And I recommend, especially if it's a community, like you're building a community Game World, to study them.
Thank you.
Yeah.
For saying this.
And do you propose that having them aware and speaking about them, that is what makes the time shorter of them actually causing pain, these phases?
Yes. And just being aware of them, you can even avoid them completely.
Okay.
Yeah. I will send an email to all the people who registered right after this, the recording also.
So we have 1 minute and there's still a couple of people who didn't speak. There's Israel and Dor. Is anybody, or Zana?
I'll speak. Beth wants to speak.
Go ahead.
Hi. Yeah, because I got really excited during this to talk about what I'm interested in, which is like becoming an Archan clinician, because I'm really into this concept of like how we nourish all the five bodies, how we were talking about it in the Archaearchal Women's Group. How do we like take care of those baseline needs? I myself have had cancer. I've had a lot of physical ailments, and I've had a couple EHPs where after the EHP, the pain went away. The cut like went like healed. These kinds of really magical moments with my physical body. So yeah, I'm really lit up about the physical body and how the EHPs are this direct way and how we can speak to our organs. And so I'm now going to involve myself with the healing practitioners clinic weekly. And this is my path. So,
wow.
Thank you.
Well, it's so powerful. Thank you.
Yeah. You got to talk to Yurdis Tielsch. She's also just thinking about designing a program to bring all this information to doctors. And so, So I think maybe you two might have something to share.
Will you write her name in the chat, please?
I have an invitation, following also Vera's invitation. I have an invitation that most of you are in the Creation Village, and if you could share this vision of your game world in this village as a way to just create this field of, there's all these facets of Archaearchy that are coming to life.
Yes.
Would you do that? Mm-hmm. And it doesn't need to be clear. That doesn't need to be, it's wherever you are, whatever you're holding space for. Okay.
Well, thank you all for jumping in this rapid fire space. Really, thank you for the work that you're doing and your commitment to entering the unknown and still inventing it. Like, it's just inventing it as you go along. It's so important what you're bringing. So please go through the EHPs, connect with your team, give it a name, build a website, just start telling people about it. And just one step at a time, that's how it goes.
I'll say one thing, that this is really what the path is about, in my opinion. Like, the path is not about healing ourselves or becoming enlightened. I think the path is really about holding space for what we love.
Yeah.
And sharing it with other people. So it's an exciting part of the path.
So thank you really for spending your time now, being here together, and go for it. Really go for it. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you, team. Thank you for all the sharing.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.